Welcome to our English ministry service at Alhambra True Light Presbyterian Church. I want to invite you to join us in the call to worship that is taken from Daniel chapter 4, verse 37, and invite you then to join us in prayer together. Hear the reading now and give your attention to the call to worship, Daniel 4, 37. Let us praise and exalt and glorify the King of Heaven, because everything he does is right and all his ways are just. Join me in prayer. Gracious and almighty God, we believe in you. Help our unbelief. We praise you for Jesus Christ, who purchased us and won us. We love you, yet not with all our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. Work in us what is pleasing in your sight, and be glorified in us as we worship you through our Lord Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. Join me in singing praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. O ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Praise him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord for all things so wondrously reigneth. Shelters thee under his wings, ye so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen?
Welcome you to our service today and invite you now to give your attention to the reading of Holy Scripture from Acts chapter 2 today, reading verses 37 through the end of the chapter, verse 47. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." With many other words, he warned them, and he pleaded with them, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people, and the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Thanks be to God for the reading of his word. Will you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the scriptures and for this word. We pray your anointing on the message, that you would bless and build up your church. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, in his name we pray, amen.
Dear brother and sister in Christ, either you are here or you are online, it was so wonderful and it was amazing that we can come to the sanctuary and worship God. As I sit down there for the past 2 weeks that we are test running the reopening, and I certainly have a thought is, we have been thinking about that we can sit here to worship God is something taken for granted, right? We just so get used to it. But now, as I thought, nothing is taken for granted. Everything we can do today, even our breath, we can walk, we can go everywhere, it's the grace of God that we can worship God together. Today I want to share with a message, the title is Back to the Basics of Church, and the scriptures is in the book of Acts on chapter 2, 37 and 47. Pastor Jack just read the scripture to us. And if you have the Bible at home, I would ask you to open the Bible and look at the text, and we studied it together. After all these long, long months in pandemic, we finally are preparing and get almost ready to come back to meet in person and worship God together. We have been through a year of chaos in many ways. As you have experienced in your life, your social life, your work, your school, and your health, almost every aspect of our life are being affected. And our church fellowships is no exception. Our church are going on into an unusual mode of ministry in the pandemic. But we thank God for the technologies that can help us to worship and connect to each other in a sort of a limited way. But now as we are gradually getting back to the normal, and you may realize that it won't be the same old way anymore. It will not be the same. There are things that will be changed forever. And the only thing unchanged that I can see is the same and always remain the same is God is in charge. God oversees everything. It is very important for us to review as we are reopening as a church why we are here, what we are trying to do and what we are trying to accomplish, and what should we change to make things happen that the way will please God. So today I want to talk about is, it is the time for us to review, to reconsider and rethink things that we do in the ministry, particularly in a time like this. As we plan how we should go forward for the day to come, and I think it is always helpful to look back in the history and see what happened in the history and how do the people over back then do will give us a hint on what we should do today. In the chapter 2 of the book of Acts is the birth of the early church. If you look at that chapter, you will see that it's the church was born in a series of shock of social incidents. If you survey the Gospels and the book of Acts, and you can see that the whole social impact that start with Jesus himself with his ministry in Jerusalem. When people see what he did and hear what he preached, people were in awe. But shortly follow, Jesus being seized by the authority and die on the cross. And 3 days later, come the resurrection. And now, 50 days after that event, came the Pentecost, and the Holy Spirit descend and fill the apostle. And the 120 gathered at that time, they can talk in a foreign language to those who were in Jerusalem to observe the Pentecost. They can tell them about Jesus. So people were so amazed of the work of the Holy Spirit. So after Peter talked on verse 14 to 36 on chapter 2, that talk from Peter is the very first sermon in Christianity. And people soon realized that the people at that time, that the audience of Peter, they have killed the one that God sent and made to be the Messiah. The Lord is Jesus. So today in the scripture that we read in verse 37, it said, they were cut to heart. And on that same day, 3,000 were baptized and became the followers of Jesus Christ. And this is the beginning of the Christian church. Now, if you look at that text in here, that even though the authors of the book of Acts and the authors of Gospel did not mention so much of the societal reaction in general within this incident, the author of Gospel didn't mention so much about it, nor did the look on the book of Acts. But you can sense those impact when we read the Gospel, Luke 24:18. Remember, those two apostles walked with Jesus, but of course they didn't recognize Jesus on the road to Emmaus. One of the apostles said to Jesus, he said, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" So you can imagine that all the people in Jerusalem are in a shock of what had happened to them. The church start and such a social impact in eventually changed many people's life at their time. And that's the whole purpose of the church. That's the reason that the church exists, is to change people. So I want to ask you a question that you want to consider. What is your opinion of an ideal church? I wouldn't even use the word perfect church. There's none. What is your imagination about an ideal church? Imagine that if you are moving to a new place and you're looking for a church, what does that important to you to fit in as a good church? Of course, maybe very strong biblical teaching, people friendly, great facility, very convenient, lots of parking space, have a great children program, and so on. So we all have an idea of what is ideal church in our head. But if we are looking at the world today and look back at history, 2,000 years in the history of the church, there was no ideal church, and there was no perfect church. Perfect church doesn't exist. Small church have small problem. Bigger church have bigger problem. And mega church could have mega problem. And the only ideal church that we can say is the church in the book of Acts chapter 2, the earliest church. And all this year, church has changed a lot, good or bad. In the past 20th century, you see that some of the denomination, they developed some sort of ritual that I look at it, it's kind of strange. But as long as it helps people to come to Christ, that's okay. But unfortunately, sometimes those rituals doesn't help at all. So I want to say is whenever we are confused about a time, especially that we are now at the time of a pandemic, we are confused of what we are going ahead, how we are going ahead, and what is the next step that we're gonna do. And we are actually not sure how to proceed with the next phase of our church life. And it's always important and helpful to look back and revisit the basic. What are the basic? In Acts chapter 2, we always call this chapter the chapter of the church. If you read it carefully, you will find that there were events that happened in order. First, the descent of the Holy Spirit. It is the most important and the key event here. And you remember because Jesus told the apostle, don't go anywhere, stay here and wait for the Holy Spirit to come. So it is important. Then the second event coming is Peter spoke to the Jews, came from all over around in the area in the Pentecost festival. Then came the birth of Jesus Christ. Start with the 3,000. It is very significant for us to understand this event and what they meant for us. First, come the filling of the Holy Spirit. The coming of the Holy Spirit is the most important and the key factors in here. Then come the gospel, the proclaiming of the gospel from Peter. And then the third is the coming of the church. So the first essential of the church is the filling of the Holy Spirit. No Holy Spirit, no church. It will require a whole another talk to talk about the coming of the Holy Spirit in order to go deeper. But I do want to mention this for you to think about and your attention is if you look at chapter 2 in verse 3 and 4, it mentioned here that the Holy Spirit rests on each of them and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. There are two steps in here. The Holy Spirit rests on them and they were filled. It was a passive mode in here. So there are two steps, rest and be filled. So here is the point that I want you to think about. On both personal level and on a church level, we can be touched by the Holy Spirit, but not being filled by it. Think about it. We Christians need to be touched, but also to be filled by the Spirit. But I'm not going further for this. I want you to just think about it. And let's go on and we see that when Peter preached the very first sermon in here in chapter 2, and you will be aware that his sermon took up a very big portion of this chapter here. What did he talk about? He talked about the salvation of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the Messiah, the Savior that they have been waiting for years. Yet, when Jesus come, they nail him on the cross and kill him. But God makes great things out of the bad. God raised Jesus from the dead. So in Peter's preaching, Peter challenged them to repent, return, and be saved. So what we can learn in Peter's sermons is even though his target audience at that time is specifically for the Jews, but there was one important point that is true to any generation that we need to remember. When we come to reaching out to people to save their soul, one key thing must be in place. Repent. No repent, no salvation. But this day you will see a lot of Christians, so-called Christians, did not go through that process. Why? Because sometimes we will normally feel awkward to share our faith to begin with and not even ask people to repent. But you never know what God will do in people's heart. In verse 37 said in here, when people heard what Peter say, they didn't come up and hit him and kill him. They were cut to the heart. It's not Peter's work. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. And they repent and return. Brother and sister, during this time of COVID, I really heard a few of my friends and people that I know is not a believer. They voice out and mention about their shock and their fear. They express their thought and concern about the eternity and the meaning of life, which they never have thought of. But the time bring them to this point that they think about all this important matter. So it is a good opportunity for us to share our faith because we know that God is certainly at work at any time, even a bad time or chaos time like this we are in today. And here in verse 47, on that same day, there were 3,000 added to them. 3,000 respond, repent, and return, and be saved. Now look at the church today. We have church that developed from a handful of people or less than 100 people, and then it developed into a mega church of 1,000. Yes, we see churches like this. But you can imagine the astonishing effect for the apostle at that time is that in one day the increase is 30 times, from 120 to 3,000. And it is not finished yet. If you look at verse 47, what does it say? The Lord add to their number daily those who are being saved. So 3,000 is just to begin. So just imagine that. How are we going to minister that many people at the certain? Think about that. If the Holy Spirit worked miracle and do this to us today, and what are we going to do? I think we're going to just set up a several committee and a meeting and then start to talk about what we are to do. But let's look at what they do back then in the earlier church in such a scale of impact. Verse 42 tells us, it says, they devote themselves to the apostle teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. So here are the four things that they did: to study, to devote to the teaching. To study, in another translation, it said they were continuing steadfastly in the teaching of the apostle. They were continually studying the word. It was not a one-time incident, but all of them engaged in a continuing daily study of God's word. Devote to study God's word and follow has always been the first priority in church life. In other words, all believers ought to participate in some way of studying of the word. not just only listen to the sermon every Sunday, but to engage in a community form of study. It is very essential part for a Christian life is to grow in God's word. Why? Because in 2 Timothy 3:16 to 17, here's what the scripture said. He said, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. So the second thing they do after that to study is to fellowship and breaking bread together. Fellowship means they were together, communicate, and having a close relationship. We are missing the togetherness for so long, and that's very essential and cannot be a missing part in a fellowship. And fellowship also means to support each other, to comfort each other, and also mean also say that they are sharing to each other. If you look at verse 44 and 45, here is the text saying, all the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possession to give to anyone who had need. Whenever we read this part of the text, we were like, wow, that's amazing. But what does that mean? What does that mean to us? How should we understand this? And how does that apply to us? Are we supposed to do the same? So the original words language in here, the implication here, did not mean that or did not show that it was an obligation for all Christians to do so. But it mentioned here that they operate in the condition of a sacrificial love and trust of others. We need to understand that with such kind of acts in the early church, what is the consequence and what is the result of it? They gain the favor of all people. That's it on verse 47. In other words, you can imagine the people at that time, what people think about this Christian at that time. They will think like, these people are acting strange if they don't think that they are crazy. But they like them. They like what they do. So verse 47 said, the Lord add to their number daily those who are being saved. Brother and sister, we Christians today, we really have not much interest to act out of so-called ordinary. We want to be blend in. We want to be assimilate ourselves to others. But if you remember what the church, the word church in the original Greek meaning, the church means the people are called out, are people to be called out. So we are not meant to act like the rest of the world. But that doesn't mean that we act like crazy either. But we still have to act in a almost sounds like crazy way, but become all favor to all people. So at that time, what actually drew them to Christ was not so much because of the apostle performed signs and wonder, but because the acts of the Christian at that time, how they pursuing the word and how they worship and how they fellowship and how they pray, that attract people to Christ. So whenever we consider why a church is a church and what a church is supposed to be and what makes a church church, we always have to refer back to Acts 2 to reposition ourselves of what a church ought to be. In this chapter, you will find a very core element to be a church of Christ. First, definitely the basis of all is the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. Then the proclaim of the gospel by Peter. And the member who devote themselves to study and follow God's word, to fellowship with others in a sacrificial way, to worship Christ by breaking of bread, and to diligently pray. So, five things: to proclaim, to study, fellowship, worship, and pray. That's the very base of all. Now, as a church of 21st century, church are certainly very different from the early church. But when the church is in an unusual time, just like how we are today, it is a time of dealing with change, a time to call for us to adapt to a new era of church life. There are many unknown things ahead of us. You guess it. We don't even know what to do in the future. So as you always listen to people to say that we are not going to be normal anymore. After the COVID, going to be a new normal. And the ministry of the church are no exception. And what will be the new normal for church? And more important is, based on what for us to define the new normal? And you know, everyone could have their own opinion on how to do things. Because everyone would have different ideas about what is important and what is the right thing to do for the church. And sometimes people can be very strong-minded about it. And I included myself. Sometimes I have the thought and I do it the way that I said, well, either do it my way or don't do it. That kind of attitude. But as I look back at the early church, it indicates that the very core mission of the church. So whenever I think about something that I want to share with others and share about what we do, we as a church that we need to do, I always ask myself, what I am going to raise and talk about, does that fit this five question here that I show? Does that help people to reach out to the unsaved? That's proclaim. And second, does that help people to get a deeper understanding of God's word? That's study. And the third, does that helpful to the fellowship for caring of the church bodies? That's fellowship. And the number four, is that a must in helping people worship God? Is that helpful for people to worship God? That's worship. And finally, does that help people in prayer and to come close to Christ? If any of this question have a negative response, then I would say what I think doesn't even matter. So brother and sister, in a challenging time like this, we need to learn. We need to learn to give way to each other. We need to learn to yield to each other for good. Rather than we looking at what is important to me, we are looking at how the Holy Spirit will guide us to focus on what is most important for the kingdom of God. I think you all have the experience and look at enjoying in the orchestra, in the concert. If you're ever in an orchestra concert, that you will notice this. Before even the performance will start, the musician will warm up. They each play, they have their own instrument and they play whatever the note, whatever the key they want to play, just to warm up. But finally, the concert master will step to the podium and have them all play the same chord. And the concert master then point at one instrument, usually the first pianist or the other, and told them that this is the standard. And everybody tune the instrument to that sound. And then when the conductor stepped to the podium, and a beautiful piece of music was performed. Here's what we need to know. When everyone, we tune ourselves with God's purpose, and the church will produce beautiful music. We are all different kind of instrument. We all have different feature. If we tune with God and focus on what really matters to all, to the kingdom of God, not just about ourselves, then we can produce beautiful music to please God. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you, and we pray that you steer us into your Holy Spirit on how to focus on you and help us to fellowship in a way that will glorify you, so that people will come because they see our act of worship, fellowship, prayer, and study of God's word. Bless and guide us in Jesus' name. Amen.
God is three in one. believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again.
We thank God that you could join us today in worship, in praising the Lord, and hearing this message. And we pray indeed that you would be encouraged and built up in your faith, and that if you do not know the Lord, you would listen to this message and realize that you too can repent and return to him. And so we encourage you this day, and we thank God for the opportunity to praise him with you. Before receiving the benediction, just remember to check out connections for important information about coming back together again next Sunday, July 4th, for in-person worship. As you sign up for your service, for the English ministry service, just pay attention to connections and the protocol. We are wearing masks again. I have mine right here. And we're going to be wearing masks unless I'm at the pulpit or our singers are singing. And that we're going to do that for, I think from our reopening committee, we're going to be doing that for a few Sundays, and then we'll be reevaluating. But wear masks, make sure that you pay attention to that protocol. Also, if you want to be looking ahead and wondering what's going on in English ministry, the messages will be from the book of Galatians from chapter 2. You can also find that information in connections as well. Finally, next Sunday is Communion Sunday as well. We're coming back together again on July 4th, and it's Communion Sunday. You'll notice as you come in to the sanctuary, there'll be a table with the individual servings for communion. Just pick that up and bring it with you into the sanctuary so that you're ready for when we observe the Lord's Supper in the service. So we thank God that you could join us and now receive his benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be upon each and every one of you. Amen.